right, so here we are back at the lab environment. And now that we've gone through the systemd file and the configuration file for MinIO, we can go ahead and actually implement that on the server. But first, we need to do some setup tasks. So we're going to go ahead and walk through those first. So because we want to run this as a user, MinIO user, we actually need to add that user and a group for that user, create a home directory and some other directories for where the TLS certificates will live and copy those over and all those kind of things. So let's just walk through that and I'll walk you through everything I'm doing. So the first thing I'm going to do is go ahead and do group add and add the group MinIO user. Next, we're going to go ahead and create the MinIO user itself and add it to the MinIO user group. Next, we will want to actually become that user that we just created. So we'll do su MinIO user. And we want to make a directory on where we're going to store the certs. The certs need to be stored in a specific directory. It needs to be located in the user that you're going to be using, .minio. So their home directory, .minio/certs. So we will create that directory as the user so it has the proper permissions. We can then exit out of being that user and go back to being the root user. Next, we want to create that /mount/data directory that we discussed earlier where we're going to keep our MinIO data. And we want to make sure that we change ownership of that so that the MinIO user can actually do everything it needs to in there. So we'll run chown MinIO user as the user and group and against mount data. In this case, I installed MinIO using the .deb package. And it automatically creates the systemd file when you do that. If you're using the binary, it does not auto-create. But in our case, this already exists. So we can do systemctl status minio and actually see that it exists already. And we can actually take a look at that. So if we do cat etsy systemd system minio service, we can actually see that that file that we reviewed earlier is already there. And it has the expected values that we want in here. So it's got the proper user in here. It's also referencing that environment file that we created and discussed earlier. We actually haven't created that yet. We're going to create that next. And it's got all the other settings in here that we expect to see. So you will need to create this if it doesn't exist already. But in our case, it does already exist. So we'll just use the one that's in place here. Next, we are going to create that etsy default minio file for the configuration file. So we'll go ahead and use vi for that. And this is where we will actually place that configuration that we discussed earlier. So we can just pop that in there. Again, we're using mount data. That's the directory we just created with those options. Address is 9000, console address is 9001. User is the minio admin, the root user for minio. Super secret password, and then this will be our environment. And this is important, again, because the TLS certificate will match to dsodemo.org in this case. So we want to make sure that that is valid. So we'll go ahead and save this file. And now that's in place. Next thing we want to do is actually make sure that the MinIO user owns that file. So we'll run a chown, again, MinIO user user, MinIO user group, against etsy default minio. So now we get on to the TLS certificates that it's going to be looking for here. In this case, we need to, again, put those in the home minio user.minio/certs directory, and we will need to take ownership of those as well. We can copy those as the root user. I actually already have those copied to my system here. So if I do an ls, you can see I have a private.key and public.cert file. So what we'll do is we will copy private.key to home minio user.minio/certs. And the same goes for the public.cert. Next, we need to take ownership of those for the minio user. So we'll do chown minio user, the group minio user. And that's at home minio user.minio certs private.key, and same goes for public.cert. And so now the proper ownership of those files is there. That's in the proper location. So when the actual service comes up, it will know where to look. And now that everything's done, so we've created the user, the group, We've taken the proper ownership. We've created the proper directories. We've moved the TLS certs where they need to live. The systemd file is in place and the configuration file is in place. Now we should be ready to go ahead and start the service up. So let's do sudo systemctl start main.io dot service. Or we can do a systemctl status main.io. And we can actually see that it's up and running and referencing the proper URL for this. So hopefully we can access this on 9001. Do not use the IP address because the cert that we've loaded isn't valid for this IP address. It's only valid for the domain name. So let me go ahead and open that up for you so we can see that up and running. And here we are at the login screen. And so you can see that this is actually using connection is secure and certificate is valid. We're using Let's Encrypt cert here, but you can use whatever certificate authority that you like. This was pre-generated, so I just grabbed the files that were generated using CertBot and loaded them in here. But you could do this automatically through some service, but we just grabbed those from Let's Encrypt and manually uploaded them in this case. So let's go ahead and make sure that we can, in fact, log in using our super secret password. And there we are. So now we have a service that's up and running. It will persist. Actually, no, it won't persist yet. Let me take a step back. We actually need to do one more thing. So we need to do systemctl enable main.io. And now that enables the service to run on startup. So now every time we reboot the system, this service should come online. And just to make sure that everything is working as expected still, we can create a new bucket, you know, systemd test. We'll go ahead and upload a test file. Same 1 gigabyte test file there. So this should upload rather quickly. That's done uploading. And because this is running in background, remember last time we actually had to go to a second window, keep the service running in the foreground when we ran it from the command line and actually access this. We don't need to do that here because this is running in the background. So what we can do here is run tree minus H for human readable mount data. We can actually see that the main.io systemd test directory was created, same as the bucket, and that 1 gigabyte file was there. And you can see that since there's only one file, it did not divide it up anywhere. It simply put the entire 1 gig file here. And there's also a metadata file here as well. So that's really all there is to it to get this up and running in the simplest fashion, have it running persistently as a systemd service rather on your host and have it persist through reboots. And now you can start to really scale this out and make all of these steps that I just did manually or showed you just manually as part of your automation platform, whether you're using Ansible or Chef or Puppet or whatever you like to use. You can actually bake all these processes in so that when you need to go and deploy many of these services and make them highly available, highly redundant, and distribute them across, you know, whatever range of locations, data centers, things like that, regions around the world, this should be pretty straightforward for you to be able to do that as well. So that completes the lab portion for this. I appreciate you watching, and let's jump on to the next video.